Magandang araw po sa inyo lahat. Ako po si Christian Esgarat. Welcome po sa ating special episode ng ating Facts First Podcast. Alam niyo po, doon po sa mga sumusubaybay po dito sa ating podcast since 2019, alam niyo po, isa po sa mga issues na tinututukan natin ay yung pong mga nangyayari at yung mga developments po doon po sa bagong Bangsamoro Autonomous Region and Muslim Mindanao o yung BARM. Okay? So sa araw na to, meron po tayong pag-uusapan kasi alam nyo po, ang dami nangyayari sa Pilipinas, no? Pero hindi po natin pwedeng hindi bigyan ng karampatang attention po yung nangyayari po sa BARM, no? Dahil meron pong kasulukuyang transition dyan. Okay? So napaka-importante po nito para talaga matapos, makumpleto yung pong matagal na pong sinimulan na peace process. Okay? So pag-uusapan po natin ngayon yung Bangsamoro Parliament. Alam niyo naman po na parang sinasabi na yung asymmetrical yung relationship yan dahil iba yung sistema natin dito sa national, di ba? Pero pagdating doon sa Bangsamoro, sa BARM, meron silang parliament. Tingnan natin, kumustahin natin kung paano po ba yung nagiging takbo niyan. So sa araw na to, meron po tayong dalawang special na panauhin. Pareho po silang miyembro ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority. I'd like to welcome to our podcast si Deputy Speaker Liza Alamia at saka po si Member of Parliament na si Attorney Ishak Mastura. Magandang araw po sa inyo lahat and welcome po dito po sa ating Facts First Podcast.
Hello, magandang araw sa lahat ng mga sumusunod, sumusubaybay kay Christian Esguera dito sa Facts First Podcast.
Okay.
Attorney Good evening Shop. Po.
Okay.
Good evening po.
Okay, maraming salamat sa inyo, no? Dito po sa pagpapa-unlock nyo kasi nga I think importante po na maintindihan po ng general viewers at saka listeners kung ano po ba itong Bangsamoro Parliament, no? Okay, siguro konting paliwanag muna. I'll start with Deputy Speaker Liza, no? Bakit pa nagkaroon ng parliament? Eh wala naman tayong ganun, 'di ba? We have a Congress, pero dito, bakit mayroong parliament dito sa Bangsamoro Autonomous Region and Muslim Mindanao?
Well, unang-una, it's part of one of the agreements dun sa peace agreement that was signed between the government of the Philippines and the MILF. Kasama yon sa comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro. And then when the law was drafted, yung organic law, the Bangsamoro organic law, nakasaad doon that the kind of government that would be set up in the Bangsamoro would be parliamentary in nature. So it is based on law. It is also what has been agreed upon politically between the government and the MILF.
Mm-hmm. And so far, kumusta po ba yung takbo ng parliament? Kumbaga, yung mga miyembro ba ay somehow adjusted na doon po sa kalakaran sa isang parliament? Attorney Liza?
Actually, hanggang ngayon, nag-a-adjust pa rin, no? Nag-a-adjust pa rin kami because... And then at the same time, hindi kami elected. So since 2019, when the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region and Muslim Mindanao was set up, nag-appoint ng mga members of parliament ang former president, si President Duterte. And then by 2022, nag-appoint naman ulit nung na-extend yung transition ay nag-appoint si President Marcos ng mga miyembro ng BTA. So until now, this is the second BTA for another 3 years until 2025. Hopefully, may election na by 2025. I appointed kami lahat. So in a way, hindi siya totally gaya ng in-envision natin sa batas and sa comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro for now because we're still in transition. Mm-hmm. But the members of the parliament, the BTA, are already doing their job, but mostly where we are trying to set up the foundations for the first elected regional government in the 2025.
Okay. Hey nga pala, if you want to say something, well, no, okay, mahiya, no? Huwag niyo na ako intay magtanong if you want to say something already.
Yes.
Attorney Ishak, yun sa inyo po, what did you find, what have you found most challenging dito sa pagiging miyembro po ng parliament?
Una sa lahat, just balikan lang natin ng kaunti, no, sa a little bit of history. I was part of the peace negotiations as a part of the legal team and the technical working group. At ang nasabi sa peace agreement is that we shall have a ministerial form of government. At that time, the Philippine government was still sensitive about having a parliamentary type of government because we have a presidential form of government. And there were some legal issues on whether or not we can have an asymmetric type of government wherein we have a presidential system, but for Bangsa Moro, we preferentary type of government. Mm-hmm. So this was resolved by constitutionalists. No, they reviewed it and they said that there was no problem with having a parliamentary type of government. That's why in the BOL, we don't use the ministerial form of government anymore, but we use the full parliamentary type of government, because at the end of the day, the constitution says that the executive must be elected. In this case, the chief minister is still elected, and the members are also supposed to be elected. But as Attorney Liza explained, we are in a transition, so we are all appointed. And one difference, as you said, the challenge, no, the challenge is we're not really shifting to a full parliamentary type of government yet, because under the Bangsa Moro Organic Law, executive authority lies with the chief minister, the interim chief minister. That's during the transition period. In the elected parliament, the first regular elected parliament, the executive authority will be with the cabinet. So that's why doctrines that are familiar to us, like for example, doctrine of qualified political agency, or the doctrine that the president has alter egos, no, and this is his cabinet. So they are extension of the presidency, because all executive power lies with the president. That's in the presidential form. In a parliamentary form, the cabinet is the executive authority. So right now, in this transition, we are not practicing that parliamentary form of government. So in fact, there's still separation of powers, meaning the BTA in general, the membership of AT, we function as legislators, while the cabinet, which are appointed by the chief minister, function as the executive, with the chief minister similar to a regional governor. So the hope really is that we will transform or transition to a real parliamentary system, because if we maintain this way, then we are not really practicing parliamentary government. But given the lack of time, we only have barely 2 years, no, I think it's 1.5 years more or less, the transition or the actual practice of parliamentary type of government will be done by the elected parliament.
Okay. O sige. Bago natin busisiin yung talagang composition noong Bangsa Moro Parliament, I'd like to ask your opinion regarding this. No? I'll start with Attorney Liza. Sabi kasi ni Attorney Ishak, na-resolve ng mga constitutionalists yung asymmetric relationship between the Bangsa Moro Parliament at saka yung presidential system that we have nationally. Although may mga nakakausap din tayo, sinasabi nila, ultimately, we'd have to amend the 1987 Constitution para talaga matanggal na lahat ng tanong na yan. No? Do you agree with that, Attorney Liza, first?
Well, that is true. In fact, that is envisioned by the drafters of the Bangsa Moro Organic Law and those who are part of the negotiations, as mentioned by Ishak. There are some matters that would have to be, that may only be implemented or would come into fruition if we are going to amend the constitution. But for now, the organic law, the Bangsa Moro Organic Law that has been passed has been drafted in such a way that it's going to conform to the 1987 constitution.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Kayo, Attorney Ishak, do you agree na eventually talagang the resolution ito i-amend yung 1987 constitution?
Yes, because we have a problem with regard to the general supervision of the president. Because the general supervision of the president is with regard to all local government units. And the Supreme Court already decided that the autonomous regions are a form of local governments. So it's also very specific in the constitution that the president exercises general supervision over the autonomous region. However, the difference is in the parliamentary setup, he is not supervising the person of the regional governor anymore, because we don't have any more a regional governor. Instead, he supervises the parliament, the Bangsamoro parliament, which is the Bangsamoro government. So we have a strange case wherein executive and legislative are fused in a parliamentary type of government, and he supervises the parliament even with regard to legislation. In the separation of powers doctrine, as most of us are familiar with, the president cannot intrude into Congress domain, in Congress jurisdiction. Just like the two departments also, the legislative and executive, cannot interfere with the judiciary, because that's the principle of separation of powers. But in this case, it seems that the executive, the president, can intervene in the legislation of the Bangsamoro Parliament. And that's because we have this fusion of executive and legislative. Now, at some point, maybe if the president really exercises that supervision, there will be a question in court. No, if we pass a law that the president does not agree or tries to stop the passage of a law, then we will have an issue that will be raised in the courts, and we will find out whether or not the parliamentary system really fits into the current constitutional setup. So we need to resolve that eventually. If it can be resolved in the courts, then eventually, good. But ultimately, we might have to change the constitution.
Ayun ang hintayin natin. So far, hindi pa naman nangyayari, no? Kumbaga, medyo hands off pa naman ang national government dyan, no? Okay, pag-usapan natin po itong yung mandate, no? Kasi as you explained, the both of you po, ano sabi nyo, yung members ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority, para po sa ating mga viewers, sa ating mga listeners, yan po yung interim government, yung para maitawid, no? Until the first parliamentary elections in 2025. Dapat po ginawa kasi yan in 2022, pero the previous Congress granted an extension of another 3 years. Ang tanong ko po sa inyo, kasi ang mandato, no, I know this is a touchy issue, eh. Sinasabi ng iba na, yung ibang observers, sinasabi nila, problema ba yung walang mandato ngayon during the extension in particular in terms of, let's say, legislating policy? Natatanong ba kayo sa ganun? Teka, appointed kayo lahat, eh. Hindi yan yung real parliament na talaga in-expect namin na merong clear mandate coming from the people. Is that a reality na nararanasan niyo po? Attorney Liza first.
Yes, actually, people have been asking that question. And we always answer na nasa Bangsamoro Organic Law, yung Bangsamoro Transition Authority. So the direction is actually to set up the kind of a parliamentary democracy where the chief minister is elected by and answerable to the parliament. And he will actually derive his or her democratic legitimacy from the legislature. But that would happen in 2025 when we will have the election where the BARM's chief minister will be elected by the parliament and the votes will be driven by the dominant party or the party group. And like now, wala namang political parties for now loob ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority. Gaya ng sabi ni Ishak, during the transition, may fusion kasi ng executive at saka ng legislative. So somehow, hindi nangyayari yung in-envision natin kung paano yung parliamentary form of government where supposedly yung the power of general supervision, walang hold supposedly ang president, hindi siya pwedeng mag-intrude into the, kasi may separation of powers eh, dun sa power ng parliament to pass laws. Pero for now, dahil transition pa, appointed kami lahat, kaya naku-question yon. And in fact, one of the laws that we have passed, the Bangsamoro Electoral Code, has been questioned by the group of governors in the BARM at nang-file sila ng case sa Supreme Court. Pero by for now, no? Pero by 2025, ideally, ang mayayari ay kapag na-elect yung ang members of the parliament, and then the members of the parliament will elect the chief minister. The chief minister who will be driven by the dominant party or party group who will win in 2025 will then set up the government of the day. Yun yung totoong government of the day. Unlike now, appointed naman kami lahat, pero may tinatawag tayong government of the day, pero hindi pa ganon. So, yung chief minister can now exercise executive authority on behalf of the parliament through the government of the day. And then it's the one that will formulate a platform of government subject to the approval of the parliament. Para lang maintindihan ng ating mga viewers kung ano yung pagkakaiba ng BTA at saka nung elected parliament by 2025. So, in other words, yung agenda will ng government of the day that's led by the chief minister will be more or less the policy agenda of the parliament without prejudice to the legislative or review process that would be set forth by the parliament as long as they have the parliament's confidence. So it will be very different yung political dynamics, yung structure, yung composition by 2025, no? May changes sa leadership ng parliament, will be elected by the people, not appointed. There will be a regional political party system that would be set up, which is a vital aspect of parliamentary democracy in the BARM. Unlike now, where we do not have parties and party agenda, wala na ngang, dati akong minority floor leader, wala nang minority ngayon. But in 2025, half of the MPs will be political party representatives, especially those with the greatest representation in the parliament, and they will have immense influence in shaping the parliament, specifically in exercising parliamentary scrutiny and holding the government of the day accountable. This one is very important. Christian, I'd like to emphasize on that, on accountability. Now, this function, you will not find this, it is not expressed in the current laws or in practice, but it is very important in dispersing political power in the regional government. So yung pag-exercise ng parliamentary scrutiny by the parliament and holding those in the government of the day accountable.
Okay. Teka na, banggit ni Attorney Liza na. Perhaps siguro, Attorney Isha can also answer this. Baka lang, ayokong palampasin. No? Importante kasi yung system of checks and balance na ganyan. No? Kung wala na minority, yes, paano po yung system of checks and balance dyan sa BTA?
Yes po. In a parliamentary setup, essential yung having an opposition. No? That's why the BARM parliament or under the ball is designed in such a way that we have political parties. Because political parties is the platform for forming opposition groups. Otherwise, you know, if it's personality based again, then they will have no advocacy. They will have no party platform. But what I would like to point out is what Attorney Liza mentioned. Yung sabi niya na accountability ng government of the day sa parliament. Kasi in a parliament system, parliament is supreme. So yung ibig sabihin noon, yung cabinet at government of the day will always have to report to the parliament. Kung anong ginagawa nila, they'll have to report to the parliament. Because the members of the cabinet, kasi hindi masyado ito naiintindihan pa ng ating publiko, are actually MPs themselves. At sinasabi ng Bangsamoro Organic Law, majority of the cabinet will be members of parliament. In reality, pagdating niya sa 2025, practically all of those cabinet members will be members of parliament. That's just the realities of power. Because the chief minister, in order to form a government, will have to give concessions. And that concessions is in the form of cabinet posts. So the way the Bangsamoro Organic Law designed our parliament, it will always be a coalition government. I don't... majority party wherein, you know, it has 41 seats. Because what we have in the Bangsamoro Organic Law is a proportional representation system wherein minorities are represented or it encourages that the minorities will have a voice. That's why you call it proportional representation. It's not winner take all. So in most likelihood, pagdating sa 2025, it will be a coalition government. So, yun po ang gusto natin makita na ma-practice yan sa 2025. Otherwise, yung current setup namin ngayon, yung executive, no, meaning the chief minister and his cabinet, are not directly accountable to the parliament because they're not reporting there as a as a group that is accountable to the parliament. Yung question hour namin, dati, in the beginning, there was a practice of question hour. The chief minister would appear and there were some questions that were propounded to him. But more and more, dito sa BTA 2, nawala na yon. Parang hindi na ngayon yung pinapractice na nagre-report yung chief minister because wala na rin yung majority-minority. Kasi nung sa BTA 1, there was a semblance of opposition because there was majority-minority. But the minority in the BTA 1 was only 7 people and Attorney Liza was the leader of that minority.
At least meron pa rin, di ba? One time na yun.
Pero ngayon, wala na po yan. In fact, there is confusion with regard to what does government of the day actually mean? Because sa government of the day, it's the whole of the membership of the BTA sa ngayon, no? So that presents its own problems, but at the same time, it facilitates consensus building kasi wala nang divide. But ultimately, it's to the detriment also of parliament kung walang opposition, kung walang dissenting voices, because that's what the essence of democracy is. Kailangan may magpupuna. Kasi sa ating presidential system, yung separation of powers doctrine, ibig sabihin, yung judiciary, yung Congress, and the presidency check each other, di ba? Yeah. Sila ang nagbabantay sa bawat departamento at doon nang gagaling yung check and balance. Sa parliamentary system, ang check and balance really is having strong opposition parties and yung platform sa parliament na nagre-report yung government of the day. Accountable siya sa parliament. Actually, we had an opportunity sa umpisa ng BTA 2 kasi yung law na extending the BTA only provided that there shall be 80 members that will be appointed by the president. Wala pong nilagay doon na the chief minister will be appointed by the president. That was in the BTA 1. No? Sa BOL, previously, the chief minister was going to be appointed separately from the other members of parliament in the BTA. But in the extension law, nawala yun. It just said the president will appoint 80 members. So if we were given a chance, sana nag-appoint na lang ng 80 members, tapos pinaalaw kami mag-vote ng yung government na chief minister. If we had voted for a chief minister, kahit sabihin na natin, 41 were nominees of the MILF, mananalo naman at mananalo, no? And there will be political persuasion na dapat ituloy yung setup na MILF-led. Okay lang yun. Pero there is a semblance of democracy. There's a semblance of accountability. Kasi binoto mo siya. So ngayon, wala. Now, with regard to naman, I think ang unang focus mo, Christian, was yung mandato from the people. Meaning, kasi appointed kami, so ang mandato namin is from the appointing authority. No? Our legitimacy emanates from the president because siya naman ang nahalal. Presidente, in-appoint niya. Tapos may peace agreement. merong peace process. So yun pa ang foundation ng aming legitimacy. But yung galing sa tao mismo, wala yun. Wala yun. So
wala pa,
that's
wala
why
pa.
Incumbent upon us to work with the local government units. Because yung mga local government units, ang mga officials niyang, local officials, nahalal sila. Sila ang merong mandato ng people, no? In the governors, the mayors. So we have to have good working relations with them because sila na halal. We have to give them the appropriate respect, no? Kami appointed, sila ay elected. So we have to bridge that gap, which sad to say, merong gap na nangyayari because there is a misunderstanding. Because yung BTA, ang tinitingala niyan, ang kanyang primary mandate is to be answerable to the appointing authority, which is the presidency. Okay. So hindi niya tinitingnan yung dun sa ground. But sinabi naman ng let's give due regard, no, sa sinabi ni President Marcos nung inappoint niya kami na if you want to win elections you have to perform. So that what does that mean? Meaning we have to perform na satisfied yung constituency. And of course the biggest constituency are the local officials themselves. So if they're not satisfied with the way we are running things, definitely they will choose other people. We lack the performance that the president told us, no? That we should. So yun lang magiging challenge come 2025. Okay. But I think we'll come to that point na, you know.
Sige. Opo. Pupuntahan natin yung ano, yung election sa
democratic system.
Ayun, sige. Babalikan natin yan sa issue ng 2025 election. So, pero balikan ko lang muna sandali sa accountability kay Attorney Liza, no? Eh kung nawala na yung opposition, so paano naging accountable lang ano, ang quote-unquote government of the day? O baka naman isipin na iba, baka puro yes men and women na lang dyan sa, ano, sa BTA. Paano po yung system of accountability niya kung meron man?
Well, it's a trial and error na klase ng ano, no? Pag-legislate and doing our responsibility for now as appointed members of the parliament na nag-decide na, okay, wala nang minority. Ang nangyari kasi, it was in the first BTA, it was the chief minister who chose kung sino yung magiging minority floor leader. I suppose to show a also a semblance of how the parliament would look like after the elections, kaya ganon yung nangyari. Sa BTA 2, binigyan ng option yung members of parliament to decide kung may mag-minority ba o wala. Eh, walang nag-minority. So, how do we operate right now? But you can, if you watch the plenary sessions and the committee hearings of the Bangsamoro Parliament, makikita naman natin na kahit na walang label, I think yun yung ano, if it is a relationship, walang labeling ngayon kung minority ba or majority, except for government of the day, although we had a bloody discussion on what government of the day means right now, na BTA pa lang, hindi pa tayo elected. Pero walang label, but members of parliament are actually actively questioning and doing inquiries, calling for investigations, for example, kung merong mga issues na kailangan pag-uusapan. It's challenging because hindi bago kasi siya at hindi siya unique din siya dito sa BARM yung setup right now na walang minority tapos appointed yung mga members of parliament. So kaya marami yung nananawagan na talagang magkaroon na ng elections by 2025. Which maybe will pose it will pose as a
attorney Liza nawala
yata a challenge if okay. I may no yung especially sa sorry okay can you hear me now
Papa, go ahead daw malino na po ulit.
Yes okay so yung ito yung emergent challenges that are facing the BTA Parliament. Unang-una, yung petition that was filed before the Supreme Court, which challenges the legality of the provisions of the Bangsamoro Electoral Code. So I believe that this poses a problem because it raises doubts on our policies, the policies that we passed in the BTA, and it can later put into question the legitimacy of the elections. Now, we have to remember, as I said, we are unique. We lack strong precedents here and that there will always be debates regarding the policies that we are passing right now. And so the list that we need are laws that are unclear and with provisions that are doubtful and subject to several interpretations. So I think that's one of the challenges na kailangan nating i-face head-on even before 2025. And then yung isa pang issue dahil sa uniqueness ng situation right now, wala kang appointed yung members of parliament, put into question yung mga electoral code and the other laws that we have passed or that we will pass before 2025. Yung isa pa, prepared ba and empowered yung ating electorate? Do the Bangsamoro people have the capacity to make informed decisions by 2025? No? Yun ba yung nakikita natin? I have doubts about that, yes. Kaya nga kailangan ngayon pa lang may gagawin na tayo. The goal of making sure that we have fair and meaningful elections where our citizens have the what you call the agency to choose to select the capable leaders is shared not just in the Bangsamoro, it's also shared in the entire country. But the stakes are higher in the BARM given the current context with all of those issues that I've mentioned and that you have also mentioned.
Okay, buti yan ang kayo na nag-transition, no? Yan kasi gusto kong bundahan eh. So itatanong ko rin niya kay Attorney Ishak, no? Kasi nga very crucial yung system of proportional representation. So 50% po, tama ba, ng Bangsamoro Parliament yung magiging basically party representatives. So iboboto partido, hindi yung personalidad. Pero sa assessment nyo ba, kasi napaka-importanting proof of concept nito kung gumana yan sa Bangsamoro, di ba sinasabi ng iba, baka pwedeng gawin sa national. Pero I have to see first dito sa Bangsamoro. Sa assessment nyo ba, mukha bang ready na yung electorate pagdating dyan? Yung tipong pagpili sa partido base sa advokasya, sa plataforma, hindi rin sa personalidad?
I will answer that, Christian. First of all, yun yung kailangan na mangyari, yung sinabi ni Attorney Liza na magkaroon ng information, dissemination sa ating mamamayan. Kasi yung pinaka-concern ng sa ground, no, yung sa mga nakausap ko, sabi nila hindi nila naiintindihan ano yung parliamentary. So for them, they are still confused what the parliamentary type of government is. Because kung nanonood sila sa mga aming sessions, no, parang kongreso lang, parang senado lang. They don't understand na yung executive and legislative are actually fused. Of course, ang nakikita nila is the minister is also a member of parliament. So siya rin ang nagsasalita doon sa parliament, unlike in the presidential system na hindi mo nakikita ang cabinet sa Congress or sa House. So yung mga basic information about the parliament and the proportional system, no, hindi pa po yun naka-cascade doon sa ground. So sa akin, going towards that election in 2025, kailangan mangyari na po yun. At duty yun ng BTA, duty yun ng ministries even, no, the whole of government, na iparating sa mga tao, ano ba itong parliamentary system? At ano yung sinasabi nating proportional representation? The easiest answer, of course, is may analogous naman sa proportional representation, which is our party list system. As you are familiar, Christian, my father, no, the former congressman Michael Mastura, was the principal author of the party list system.
Yeah.
And in fact, the comprehensive agreement of the Bangsamoro provides for a party list system. Ang difference lang ng yung party list system sa Congress is 20% lang yung party list. Pero party list itself is defined by the law, no, yung party list system law, that it's a mechanism for proportional representation. So party list is also proportional representation. The only difference is may cap. Sa party list system, tatlo lang ang pwede mong ma-elect. Kahit na, or ma-nominate, or malagay as members of Congress. Actually, tinanong ko rin ng father ko niyan, bakit binigyan, nilagyan niya ng cap? Because according to the consultations nila sa mga constituencies, they wanted more representation. Kasi the one party could dominate the entire 20% kung walang cap. But in the case of the Bangsamoro, up to 40 yung seats na pwedeng ma-dominate ng isang partido in accordance with proportional representation, no, yung true proportional representation na walang cap. Because 50% of the seats, meaning 40 out of the 80, must be yung party system, no, party representation. So sabi ko nga, hindi naman komplikado kasi bumumoto na tayo ng party list. Ang binaboto natin yung party mismo. Hindi tayo nagboboto ng yung personality sa party list. But on the other hand, yung party list ang pinaka-ignored, di ba? Sa mga pagboto natin, hindi tayo conscious sa pagboto natin ng party list.
In fact, nagkakamali pa.
Nasalipot siya ng listahan. Yung dito yung mga local officials, yung mga national officials, pero yung listahan ng party list nasa likod. No, so hindi natin binibigyan ng importansya, kaya nga mababa yung turnout parati sa party list. And of course, we had the problem of yung hijack, no, nag-create ng partisan interest. In any case, yung sinasabi rin ni Attorney Liza with regard to our laws, that's evolving. Ang sa akin nga, ang magandang scenario is the Supreme Court will come out with a decision very soon. Bago pa matapos yung taon, mag-come out na sila ng decision. Anyway, the issues as I have read the petition are very clear. At
okay.
Hindi man magiging damaging lang sasabihin doon unconstitutional.
Attorney Ishak, nawawala yata, ano? Medyo naghang yata siya.
Oh, okay, it's back.
Okay.
So,
Go ahead, sir.
So, hindi naman late. Hindi naman nawawala. Late na mag-amend tayo ng law kung merong lumabas na ruling ang Supreme Court. At sasabihin niya, ito yung kailangan ninyong gawin. Which is what happened doon sa postponement ng barangay elections. Remember, nagpass na yung batas na postponing the elections, tapos na-declare na October yung elections, pero sinabi ng Supreme Court, kahit na ganun ang nangyari, we will still rule because important itong issues na ni-raise doon sa postponing of elections. And they came out with guidelines. Uh-oh. Yung guidelines na yun on elections, ito dapat yung kailangan reasons, no? Yung primordial doon is hindi mawala yung right to suffrage.
Uh-oh.
And then, of course, ngayon, nagsabi ang COMELEC, will question yung shortening of the term kasi 2 years lang daw. So they want it to be extended up to 2026 para ma-fulfill yung requirement na 3 years nga. So it's a form of judicial legislation, but that's the kind of system we have wherein may mix of common law and civil law. The Supreme Court can still decide on that as a matter of they are the ones that are the final arbiters of what the law is and what the constitution says actually. Yun ang nakikita kong scenario na we will have a decision by the Supreme Court and we will have time if we need to amend and conform to kung ano man yung decision ng Supreme Court.
Well, sana mag-decide soon. No? Ito, bilang panghuli, I'd like to ask si Attorney Liza. No? So, sana nga mas maunawaan ng mga botante ng electorate yung system of proportional representation sa Bangsamoro. Kasi nga, nationwide, sa observation ko rin, parang kailangan pa ng karagdagang pagpapaliwanag dun sa PR system. No? Dito sa pangkalahatan. No? Yung pag-usapan po natin bilang panghuli, yung reserve seats. Gaano po ka-importante yung reserve seats na yan? At bakit nailagay yan sa BOL?
Yes, that's a very good question. I was about to discuss that just in case hindi ma-discuss. Kasi yung parliament, the elected parliament, will not just be composed of the political party representatives. There 40% ng 80 would come from the district representatives. Ito yung the traditional na election where may mga distrito at siyempre yung mananalo dyan, yung pinaka-powerful na mga political families or politicians dun sa area nila. But we have reserved seats. So just for the information of everyone, merong 10% na remaining seats sa parliament that will be reserved for non-Moro IPs, settler communities, for women, for youth, traditional leaders, and the ulama. Now, the manner of their election is a bit complicated. It is explained and expounded yung detalye nun dun sa Bangsamoro Electoral Code. For example, for 2025, the women and youth sectoral representatives will be elected through a direct plurality of votes. Ibig sabihin, direct na iboboto ng mga tao kung sino yung kanilang representative sa parliament na manggagaling sa kababaihan at saka sa mga kabataan. Voters registration.
Attorney Liza.
Yes.
Oh, bago nyo tuloy yan, ayoko lang palapasin ng part na to. So, kunwari, boboto ng representative para isa-isang reserve seat para sa kababaihan, paano pipiliin yung mga kandidato doon? Ano yung tawag dito, categorization?
Well, meron, for example, for women. Okay. There will be assemblies sa 2025 election. Dalawang categorization yon. Sa 2025 elections, merong assemblies that will be convened by registered and accredited sectoral organizations. So magkakaroon ng assembly yung lahat ng mga women organizations, lahat ng mga settler organizations, the youth, the ulama, traditional leaders, and NMIP. And then during the assemblies, they will select their representatives. Okay? This is for 2025. It is easier, less complicated. Merong special voters registration that will be conducted for that purpose, wherein yung voter will have to identify anong sector siya para siya makaboto. So kung, let's say, gusto niya, she identifies herself in the women's sector, yun yung gusto niyang botohan, then pwede niyang i-identify yon. Actually, pwede siyang mag-identify yung botante ng up to 3 sectors to which they belong. So pwedeng babae siya, non-Moro IP siya, tapos bata siya, no, youth siya. So tatlong sector, i-identify niya yon. Magre-register siya for that para during the election, pwede niyang i-boto yung mga gusto niyang mag-represent sa kanya coming from those sectors. Now, for
sorry, last time. Napaka-importante nito kasi yeah. Ako palampasin, no? Yeah. So, syempre, yeah. Kung magre-register ka sa non-Moro IP, dapat non-Moro IP ka. Hindi pwedeng gusto mo lang bumoto ng representative doon. Tama po ba? Pag women, dapat babae
dapat
ka.
Dapat non-Moro.
Tama ba?
Dapat babae ka. Syempre. Okay. So, yeah. There will be guidelines, no? I suppose COMELEC will come up with general and specific guidelines for the first parliamentary elections in the BARM. At i-outline yan doon kung paano ka mag-register, paano ma-determine na talagang miyembro ka nga, ng babae ka nga, or miyembro ka ng non-Moro IP. So there is a way of ascertaining that by submission of certifications or accreditations coming from relevant agencies na isa-set up or na-set up na dito sa BARM. Tapos meron ding ulama at saka traditional leaders. Yun yung medyo complicated, no? Although sa 2025, assemblies lang yan. By 2028, dun sa ulama, similar to sa NMIP, sa non-Moro IP, yung sectoral representatives nila will be selected first through an assembly. Tapos through a regional ulama convention for the ulama, which will be convened based on a schedule that will set up by the COMELEC. So it's still the COMELEC who will do all of these things. The ulama council created by the Bangsamoro Darul Ifta will oversee the processes. Mag-identify sila sino ba ang patatakbuhin nila or sino yung pipiliin nila. Una, sinong patatakbuhin as representative, and then pipili sila from that during the assembly, the regional ulama convention, kung sino ang i-select nila na hahawak dun sa seat na yon for the ulama. For the non-Moro IPs, ganun din, merong tinatawag na dalawang klase, 2 levels ng assembly. The tribal assembly per tribe, kasi there are actually 13 ethnolinguistic Moro tribes, and then magkakaroon ng intertribal convention. So dun sa intertribal convention, the delegates would have to decide on their 2 representatives from among the nominees presented by the different highest assemblies per tribe. It's a bit complicated for now kung pakikinggan natin. Lalo na sa sultanate, kasi meron tayong Sultanate of Sulu, merong Maguindanao, may Kabuntalan, and Buayan, and Ranao, and Iranun. So all of this will come together in a regional convention of sultans. And you can just imagine among the Moros, ang dami-dami talagang sultan. And it would be very difficult to determine that. But COMELEC will come up with guidelines during the assembly. And then they will determine, no, the order by which each of the sultanates will represent the sector in the parliament. So 2025 election, let's say, coming from Sultanate of Sulu. 2028 elections coming from the Sultanate of Maguindanao. Sila yung magdi-decide noon. yun din yung kagandahan ng sectoral representatives, dahil yung members of the those sectors will be the ones choosing kung sino ang gusto nila na uupo doon sa parliament. And to answer your question, kung gaano ba ka-importante, ano ba yung impact ng having all of these representatives? Actually, Christian, this is the first time in the history of the Philippines and in the BARM where all of these sectors will be represented sa parliamentary level, parang sa congressional and senate level, ay merong representation coming from this different group. Siguro dahil na rin sa experience natin sa party list at the national level, ay pinasok itong very detailed na klase ng sectoral representation na gusto natin meron yung Bangsamoro Parliament. Hopefully, okay, kung ano yung na-envision natin at nakasulat, ay yun yung mangyayari by 2025 and in the 2028.
Well, sana, sana. We're hoping for that. No? Ito, final word. Attorney Ishak, final word sa inyo. No? Pakisagot na rin po ito. Dagdag nyo rin yung gusto nyo idagdag.
Yes, gusto ko lang i-remind ang ating mga listeners, no, at saka nanonood, na actually incomplete pa yung trabaho ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority sa pag conduct ng elections for 2025, dahil wala pa po yung district seats, wala pa kaming napasa na batas, separate kasi yung sa electoral code, na nag-identify ng mga district seats. So ito ba yung district seats sa ngayon ay wala rin na push ang government of the day, meaning the MILF nominees, the majority, na kanilang panukala with regard to that. So I'm a bit worried why there is that delay, because originally doon sa draft ng Bangsamoro Transition Commission, yun yung commission na nagdraft ng BBL, no, Bangsamoro Basic Law, and then which became Bangsamoro Organic Law, naka-append yun, annex yun, na merong district seats already. Pero nung pinasa nila sa Congress, inalis yun because they said it created a lot of delay, no, kasi yung some bargaining, some lobbying. So medyo magpapatagal sana yun sa pagpasa ng Bangsamoro Organic Law. So sinabi nila, let's defer it, let's give it to the parliament to pass it. So hanggang ngayon, from BTA 1 to BTA 2 na tayo, we finished already 1 year of the term na left, no, 2 years na lang, wala pa rin district seats. So there are opinions na kung wala yung district seats, hindi daw pwede mag-conduct ng election. That's just a legal opinion. In particular, during the BTA 1 extension, yun yung naging issue. Paano daw mag-conduct ng election na walang district seats? However, sinasabi naman ng iba, pwede daw yung for the first parliament, gamitin yung congressional districts, no, or yung sa regional legislative assembly sa ARM. So yun yung opinion ng iba, kasi at this point it's just a legal opinion, no, it's not never been tested. But the ideal really is we should pass already those district seats, kasi kung wala yun, hindi makukumpleto yung preparations natin for the election. And then comes now yung COMELEC also is proposing a new electoral code, that this will be in before the end of the year. Sabi nila by the end of the year they will pass an electoral code, or they will submit, rather not pass, they will submit a proposal for
sa Congress,
a new electoral code. And how does this impact the Bangsamoro? Because yung electoral code natin sa Bangsamoro is already in the Supreme Court, may question. So ang sa petition na yon, ang sa pagkabasa ko, no, because it's there, it's already out there in the internet, you can read it for yourselves. Ang argument doon is that we exceeded our bounds when we passed the electoral code, because supposedly under the BOL, yung parliamentary elections lang ang aming papakialaman, or at least yun ang gagawa namin ng batas para magkaroon ng parliamentary elections. But accordingly, doon sa petition, we exceeded yung mandate na yon. That's why nagkaroon ng questions sa Supreme Court. So this move by the COMELEC will have an impact on that case, because it means na kung ano man nilagay ng COMELEC doon sa amendments nila, it will also be implemented in the BARM. And masasagasaan din niya yon yung aming mga provisions na nilagay doon. And there is an issue kung ano bang mag-prevail. But in all likelihood, the national law will prevail because all our powers are subject to national laws and the Constitution. And in this case, the COMELEC can choose what to implement. No? Kasi sila naman yung body na nag-implement ng law. If they said, this is the higher authority or yung primordial, kasi it emanates from the Constitution, they can act on that basis, yung national law. So, hindi naman din ibig sabihin na may questions sa Supreme Court that walang way na forward na magkaroon tayo ng election. Because ang nakalagay sa Bangsamoro Electoral Code, ang guidelines po ay manggagaling sa COMELEC. So the COMELEC will be the ones to determine kung paano nila implement yung law. And that's very powerful kasi constitutional body sila eh. So they can interpret it in this way or that way in order for us to have elections. And kilala niyo naman po siguro si Chairman George Garcia, is a veteran lawyer, no? Talagang magaling yan na abogado and he knows the ins and outs of elections because that's his forte, being a former election lawyer. So timing lang din na siya ang chairman natin. So I think he can navigate it. He can navigate it so that we will have elections in 2025.
Okay, napaka-komplikado. Marami pang kalamplansya yan. And I hope mas maayos, no? Kasi nga, napaka-importante po na mag-work itong Bangsamoro peace process, no? At maging matagumpay itong transition. Maraming salamat po sa inyo, Attorney Liza and Attorney Ishak, for joining us ito po sa ating special Facts First podcast. Maraming salamat. Sa uulitin, hindi po ito yung huling pag-uusap natin, no? Invite ko po kayo uli. Maraming salamat po, sir. Tsaka po, Attorney Liza. Maraming salamat po.
Yes po. Thank you po. Thank you po.
Thank you, Christian. Thank you. Always a pleasure.
Okay. Yan po, si Attorney Ishak Mastura, tsaka po si Attorney Liza Alamia. No? Napaka-complicated po ng discussion natin. Pero I hope po ay naging malinaw naman po kahit papano sa inyo yung discussions. Kasi napaka-importante po talaga nitong Bangsamoro transition. Minsan kasi ang problema pag nasa Manila, parang wala kami pakialam dyan, no? Minsan ito yung frustration ko rin na someone who has been covering this for quite a while, no? Yung mga Bangsamoro issues. Sometimes yung ibang mga kababayan natin na nandito sa Metro Manila, parang wala silang pakialam doon sa nangyayari sa Muslim Mindanao unless siguro may violence na nangyari, mayroong pagsabog, mayroong terorismo. Pero dapat kasi mas lawakan natin yung ating pangunawa at pagkakaintindi doon sa issue. And I hope episodes like this are able to somehow expand our understanding. Kumbaga, deepen our understanding dito po sa multi-layered issue ng Bangsamoro. So maraming salamat po sa inyo lahat for joining us dito po sa ating special podcast. Ako po si Christian Esguera and maraming salamat po muli.